Gentlemen, the moment you've all been waiting for, the highlight of the day where you've all actually turned up, the speeches. So first of all, it gives me great honour to invite up the father of the bride, Roger Prentice!
I've got a light behind me so you can't see me. Okay, George, off you go. Go on, there you go. Good to watch you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us here today. It's difficult to remember when the kids were this size. They seem to grow up. They seem to grow up so quickly, at least in physical terms, if not in other terms. I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today at this wonderful day for Joanna and Greg. Thank you for joining us. Friends from Durham, old friends from St. Andrews, we have a full complement of three godparents of Joanna's here today, including Sergio, who's done a runner, no he hasn't, who's come with his family from Monaco to switch to be with us today, and Mummy Jack, who's lurking somewhere, who's over at the back there, who was Joanna's academic mother in St. Andrews. And there's been a special request to make reference to Holly's eyebrows because they're so wonderful. I'd like to thank very specially Andy for a wonderful service earlier on. Thank you, Andy. Thank you, David, for being here today, and thank you both for being part of Greg and Joanna's journey in life. And we're glad to welcome you to our family, and we hope that we will continue in times to come, as you said earlier in your sermon. And what an awe-inspiring grace you did earlier. Well done. Thank you. Today is the day for joining two families together, and it's a wonderful thing that we have these two families to join. We couldn't have asked for a better son, I don't tell you, than Greg, in all honesty. And it's wonderful that Greg's family are here today, particularly Pip and Steve, and two grandparents on your side, Doreen and Gordon, and my father, their grandfather, here today. Between them, we have two who are over 90. Including my father, who is 90 this year, and of his great-grandfather to young trouble down here. Joanna's a wonderful daughter. She has to be. She tells me all the time that she's a wonderful daughter, so I suppose she has to be. In fact, we're very lucky. We have the perfect father-daughter relationship. I know this because she gave me a birthday card some years back that told me. It said that I'm her father and she's my perfect daughter. Anna, as many of you know, she's been through many iterations of names, and Anna is the most recent and probably one that's in the sick. Anyway, I'll keep referring to Joanna, which is family name. She'd hate to think that she took after me. If you want to wind her up, just say that she takes after her father. I'm sure you could all understand why she would hate to take after me. If you don't know, you'll soon find out. She's stubborn, she's pig-headed, she's opinionated. Oh, you recognise this, do you? Argumentative, and I rest my case, how can she possibly take after me? I say she's stubborn, well, she started at quite an early age. Most babies, when they're weaned, take a few days or weeks to get over it. Joanna woke up one morning and decided, that's it, real food from now, thank you very much. And that was it. She didn't have milk after that. Caused a little bit of trouble, but we won't talk about that in public. But then she went on to continue causing a little bit of trouble. Like when she started to ride her bicycle, she spent a whole Saturday riding round and round the garden. Well, actually she didn't. She spent a whole Saturday falling off the bike, getting back on, falling off the bike, getting back on. But eventually, at the end of the day, she could ride the bicycle. And this has been the story of her life. When she decides to do something, Greg, watch out. Whatever it is, she's going to do it. It was probably her start of her love affair with Elastoplast as well. Sadly, today she's not wearing any plasters, she tells me, but we had to invest in plasters, and we imported them from Italy, from France for some years because we were using so much. And they have such better variety as they did in those days in France. And bruises. Joanna and I used to compare bruises. She's wearing a few today, so she's cunningly hiding now to maintain the tradition. Hers were from everyday life, mine were from teaching karate, but she used to win mostly, which was pretty awe-inspiring. If ever I was asked my opinion by Joanna, like, you know, do you like the green one or do you like the blue one, and I'd say, oh, I like the green one, you could absolutely guarantee me that she'd wear the blue one. It was really the same with her education. You know, if I had made any comment about her education, she'd probably be a ballerina now, studying fine art or poetry or something. So I kept well out of it. In fact, I've made a policy in life that in terms of the family, I make all the really important decisions. Things like, should the UK have a nuclear policy, what the economy is doing, and I leave the trivia to Angeta. She decides on finances, where we go and what and that sort of thing. It's much safer than that. Joanna has a very analytical mind, very sharp mind. She's quite smart, really, but don't tell her either. And certainly don't tell Gray. She researched, as you would expect, universities very deeply, and she came up with St. Andrews, which, in all seriousness, was probably one of the best decisions of her life. St. Andrews was a wonderful place in many, many ways, not the least of which there are so many friends from St. Andrews here today. And thank you so much for continuing to be part of Greg and Joanna's life, and we hope that you will for years to come. I've always tried to make a challenge for Joanna in life by making her think and asking her questions. One of the courses she did in St. Andrews was exactly along those lines, and we spent many happy days growing mustard and cress seeds, which looked more like triffids at the end, but it was a good course and she learned a lot. On the road to her first, she made some wonderful friends, and as I say, a lot of those are here today with us. Thank you very much. Greg was one of those friends. He was a demonstrator in some of her practical sessions during chemistry. She decided to study chemistry. Okay, it's not too bad, at least it's some sort of science, not a real one like biology, but it's some sort of science. Are there any chemists in the audience? You see, even chemists defect into biological chemistry. I mean, take Euan, take Greg, they see the light in the end. Anyway, she met Greg as one of her demonstrators. He was doing his PhD at the time. Greg is a great guy, a man of supreme patience. He's very creative, he's very sporty, he has a lot of emotion. This is serious. He has a lot of what do you mean? He has a lot of emotional intelligence, and let's face it, with Joanna's arrive, he has to have. We were delighted to welcome Greg to our family the first time we were allowed to meet him. We realised what a nice guy he was. He's a perfect son to welcome today formally as part of the family, and also to join the two families together, Pip and Sidney, as his parents, and all of the rest of you. I'm not going to mention you by name because I don't know who you are. Sorry, no, I can't remember. No, seriously, it's great that we can join our families together, and we couldn't ask for a better family to be joined with. Thank you so much for all of you. Joanna now is about halfway to a PhD level, I worry. She's already made huge progress. She's created some new chemicals that no one's ever made before. If any of you suffer from insomnia, have a word with her about it later. Just ask her about the hedgehogs, and believe me, you'll doze off very quickly. Greg's now having to face real life, having got his PhD, and is about, we hope, to embark on a life of postdoctoral research. Congratulations, Greg. Some of the people in St. Andrews were, let's say, a little bit more challenging than others. And Joanna's Facebook account used sometimes to have some quite alarming messages on it. I've been looking at this, I get an email saying, but believe it or not, we're linked on Facebook. I don't look at it, but sometimes you get an email and this message comes through and you think, whoa, that's an interesting message.
She never
really
quite
learned
that, did she?
She never really quite learned that. And her mother got some interesting SMS messages from some of the more dodgy characters in St Andrews.
I don't know what
you're
talking about.
Well, Euan, I mean, I don't think you'd go into that, would you?
No, I don't know what you're talking about. I mean, she might have left upon her table once.
Twice or three times.
Some messages were sent, who knows?
Well, I guess if people don't learn, I mean, what can you do?
No, you just got to teach them a lesson sometimes.
Well, exactly. I mean, how stupid can you get? So what did you think about her when you first met her?
Well, she was quite quiet, quite reserved.
No, we're talking about Anna.
She's quite outgoing, wouldn't shut up. I mean, she kept talking all the time. It was interesting watching the two of them get together in the lab. I mean, have you ever seen when you round back at school? You've got kind of girls on one side of the class, boys on one side of the class at the school disco. That's exactly how it went. They wouldn't talk to each other. They just stand opposite, and that's kind of how it went. Nobody see anything. Just kind of sneak out the back of the lab.
Well,
I think it was actually in my living room.
Are you sure you were talking about it?
Well, we were. Apparently, it was in the living room. I still say it was when we went out to help with the luggage and walk her home. But I was maybe a bit too intoxicated at that point.
You really not sure you're
not? No, it's not me at all. Not drink at all. But I mean, they kept that quiet. I don't know what it was like when he first met you, how he came across as a person, if he was outgoing, because he's quite a shy guy.
He was very shy. I mean, he was absolutely charming and lovely, but he was very shy. He got dropped in at the deep end. Other people knew quite what to make of us, which is fair enough. We don't mind this. So we don't know. I guess that's kind of fair.
He probably doesn't know what he's thinking right now. So I
think he's probably thinking about what's coming.
It's only the good folks left, Greg, don't worry.
I'm not sure whether he's spotted the sideshow yet. But, you know, if you get bored, there's a sideshow over here, by the way. It's much more interesting. So anyway, Euan, I think you're probably doing much better at this speech than I am, so I'm going to sit down now and let you finish your off.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Roger. Sorry to confuse you all, but when we started planning this, Roger emailed me quite a long time ago saying,
oh, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I had to do a joint speech, and I went, ask back if Greg won't like it. He was sitting there and squirm more because he doesn't want to give a speech.
So I said, he'll get over it.
He will, eventually, but for now, he's going to sit there and just squirm a little bit more. Now, the problem being best man first between two friends is he gets to be best man at some point for me, but luckily for me, that's not anytime soon, so I'm going to have some fun now. I did get a few rules. I'm not. People say I'm a bit uncouth. I might use foul language and speak a bit crude. Thank you. We try. I keep up appearances. But first rule was I had to say something nice about his new wife. So you did say that. Don't try and get at it now. So I'm going to try. Anna. Back when you were still at uni, you and Greg were kind of, starting to build things out. On one of the many night out, you were a bit unsure. You weren't sure if Greg liked you. You weren't sure if he liked Greg. You weren't sure what was going on. But a very wise, probably quite inebriated man once told you, that you should not worry. He knew Greg liked you. He knew everything would. Pan out, work out, it'd be fine. And that same wise man, but not as inebriated, has some more words to say to you. I told you so. You're still sat here. To Greg, you are his sky full of stars. You sparkle so bright every time. And there's not a day like today where you haven't sparkled the most. When you walked down that aisle, Greg didn't know what to do. He didn't know whether to turn around or what. But sure, when he turned around, he thought, you're looking so beautiful today. There's not a princess in the world, not even Walt Disney himself. It's a shame that he's got the beast down in that team. Unfortunately, not everyone could be here today though, and I've got in touch with a few people who wish they could be here, and they've sent a few messages. So, from Jenny Dimmock, Anna and Greg, I'm so sad not to be here on such a happy day for you both. One of the hardest things about living on the other side of the world is missing occasions like today. I wish you all the happiness in the world and for many years to come. Lots of love, Jenny. From Auntie Doreen and Uncle John, we very sincerely hope that the wedding is splendid and you have one of the best days of your life. Send warmest wishes to you and a very long and happy life together. From Megan, who cannot be here because she's off saving the world with the UN in New York, she sends her love and hopes you have a wonderful day. Now, to say something, probably you should say something nice about Brett. It would be nice to do that. So, being Greg's good friend at university, you'd expect me to come up with loads of new stories about him when he's a bit inebriated, propping the bar up, a bit unable to walk. But it's times like these, and it's that truth that I was stood next to him propping him up, so I can't quite remember those things. But other people have come to me, quite gratefully, with some stories about you, Greg. So, we'll share some of that with the room, shall we? When you were only about 2 1/4, 2 1/2, just a wee laddie. Jess had just been born, and it was our first night home from the hospital. Sorry, Jess, you might get me embarrassed. It was bath night. Just on a nice wee squeaky clean now. Jess was getting all settled down, getting ready for bed. Wee Gregory was running around, of course, already dried down. Both of them completely starkers. Now, Greg, sad that Jess is getting all attention. Just kind of wanders over, lies down on the mat next to her. So we're out. Looks back at himself. Looks back at Jess. Looks back at himself. Stevie's up into Pip's eyes. Looking away. Grabs his crown jewels and then turns around and says, pull that off. You'd think that we talked about this at all. This is what you let yourself in for, Anna. Now, there is a few other stories about Greg. From what I can gather, when he was younger, he seemed to like using hoodies as sleeping bags and tended to lose his eyebrows on nights out. Luckily, when I knew him, he actually found a sleeping bag and passed out in it, and I was either on my couch or hugging a refrigerator that time we tried to set the neighbour's tree on fire. Good night. But with Greg, I could
never use rocket.
No, that's... Yeah, he kept an eyebrow, so that was the main thing. With Greg, I could stand here and embarrass him all night about drunken stories, but I chose not to do that because I didn't think that would embarrass him too much. Greg's quite a reserved character, not many people know he's actually a diehard romantic, so I thought I'd go down that route instead. I want his name's to make you cry. So, with Anna, with this whole thing here, it was expected, it wasn't a question of question of when. A few sweepstakes went out, no one ever got it right. The whole families were together at New Year and no one, like, it didn't happen. And we were completely shot. But the big day finally came. It was such a big build-up. It was so much drama. People were so happy about it. There was messages of praises flying around all over the place. 26 plus years it all took, and it finally came to complete that climax, and I've got a wee present for you to kind of sum this up. After all that time, Sir Alex Ferguson retired from Greg's beloved Man United. So I've got a wee mug to commemorate that part. I hope it's going well.
George? See that window?
So the actual big day. Now, thinking back, thinking of you, I think it was summertime, I think it was June. Yeah, it was June. Laying back, head on the grass, we were having some laughs. It was Anna's graduation, and there was a good atmosphere. It was electric, everyone was happy. Some of the people sat here know because they graduated with Anna. It was all a bit kind of up in the air. Everyone was happy just to be leaving, and we all thought it would be popped the question then. Little did anyone actually know, Greg had come to see me in April that year on a visit in the week past and told me of his plan. He wanted to take Anna up. We're going on a nice wee romantic weekend after graduation, and that was ready to pop the question. Now, no one understands how I managed to keep that quiet, and we still don't know to this day either. So afterwards, we were out celebrating your graduation. Greg's kept us a big secret. She doesn't even know where she's going. She just knows she's going away and walks back. Now, the wise man again almost blew that by telling you to enjoy your holiday up north.
In the Highlands.
In the Highlands. That was strike one for me. I don't know how I was supposed to do it. So the big day came, they left, they went up north. They got a nice day. It was a lunch on a train, nice romantic lunch. While Greg sat at his home texting me. We planned for me to hide in some bushes. Pretty much as far as going to go. Greg had taken after his dad and was going to propose on the exact same bridge that he got down on one knee all those years ago. He drove up, he had a lovely day, thinking he's texting the lad about football scores. He was actually just texting me to make sure I was awake and actually up in the right place. I almost missed it, that was the worrying thing. But he doesn't know that, I don't know. That was strike two. There was a car park, there was only one car park up at Carbridge. And I was in such a panic that he was already there that I just dinged my car in the first available space and ran off around the corner and texted him back, I'm here, right, quick, you can come round now. And he's like, oh, I'm 20 minutes away. Oh, great, I've not got time to go with my car, I just have to leave it. So I left my car there, who pulls in?
It's not you.
No, it's not you's car. He came round, you showed Anna the bridge, and I got another text, quick, go on the bridge, get round to you now. And I sprinted round, and then he got down on one knee, and from judging by the facial expressions, you were quite happy, quite and it was a beautiful day. And to continue that, being Greg, being a diehard romantic, the engagement ring itself, you have a diamond. Not only is for most engagement rings a diamond, but it's also the birthstone of April, the one of Alana. Purple sapphire as well. Gemstone of September, which is the beginning of you two, isn't it? It's also today, September, the wedding, we're all purple for a very reason. I can't even say this, but I'll try. Sapphire?
Yeah.
Green gemstone, why? Why is it green? Something a little special happens around. And the last thing, blue diamond, she'll always carry a little bit of Greg around wherever she goes. Now, if that's not romantic, I don't know what is. We managed to keep that quiet ourselves. And that was Greg, nice and romantic, and we love him for who he is. And I couldn't have asked for a better husband, and I couldn't have asked for a better friend. Now, before I let you actually speak and try and top up against me now, there's an age-old tradition with the Florence group, again with sweepstakes. Now, obviously, first comes love. Comes marriage. Now, I went to Ladbrokes the other day, and apparently September next year and June, I've got odds on for what could happen next. So I thought that would be present, and this could be like for when he doesn't have. Oh, and since I didn't get to give you this at the reception, because apparently he didn't want to tell me their rings, he can have them as well. And that's what I thought, Dad. You just remember this, okay? So if I could ask you now, all three upstanding, grab the nearest, largest vessel you can find with some drink in it. Raise it up. Cheers, slange, salute, whatever it is you say to the bride and groom.